Agricultural groups warn about the decreasing number of farmers in the Philippines. The group Central Luzon Farmers says some of their members are forced to look for other sources of income after incurring severe losses. The Philippine Chamber of Agriculture and Food Incorporated adds traders and middlemen are not paying enough for the agricultural produce of farmers. It says this may have an impact on the country's food supply.
We will have to expect for the worst, that we will have to put a position that we are on our own. And we have to survive on our own. That is the position that we would like to take, and to call on, wake up call to the government and the private sector. Magtulong-tulong po tayo.
Now moving on to more news, a remotely operated robot has identified at least 23 leaks from the sunken Princess Empress tanker that is causing the oil spill near three Philippine provinces. Authorities are considering options on how to plug the leaks. Dennis Dato reports.
MT Princess Empress, the oil tanker that sank near Oriental Mindoro, is severely damaged. This was discovered by the remotely operated vehicle, or ROV. Based on the analysis done on the images, authorities found at least 23 cracks where oil is leaking out from the 8 tanks carrying over 800,000 liters of industrial fuel. The oil tanker sustained damage due to the high water pressure. The governor of Oriental Mindoro says there is no plan to bring the ship to the surface.
Sapagkat pag angat ng barko, because of the pressure, the vessel, it might break. Pwede siyang mabiyak. So kung mabibiyak siya at may laman ang walong tangke, it will be a disaster to all.
Authorities are looking at three strategies on how to stop oil from leaking further. The first option is through bagging using the ROV. A special bag will be wrapped around the leaking tank to contain the oil spill. The special bag will be sourced from Singapore and the United Kingdom.
Yung supot o bag ipapasok sa loob ng nagli-leak na portion, at using the ROV, hihilahin yung tali para magsara. So pag sarado na siya, so yung oil pag lumalabas, nakukontain ng bag. Tapos saka sa kukunin, papaltan ulit.
The second option is through patching where the cracks will be welded together. But this will entail more time and higher costs. And the last one is called hot tapping.
You just imagine, ito yung barko, may ipa-plug sila dyan na, no? Then they will try to extract the oil from that area. But they said that they're going to use a heating method, no, inside the tank, para medyo lumabnaw siya at ma-extract nila yung langis.
All three options can only be done using the ROV. That's why the ROV from Japan will extend its stay despite finishing its contract. According to Mayor Jennifer Cruz of Pola Oriental Mindoro, the repair or other activities needed to resolve the problem will require a different kind of contract for the use of the ROV. The amount of oil that's left in the vessel has yet to be determined, but it is confirmed that the diesel used to run the ship is gone. The U.S. Coast Guard has already arrived in Pola to aid in the oil spill response.
We are in coordination with U.S. Navy Supervisor of Salvage, who is currently readying their equipment, and technical experts on the salvage portion.
President Bongbong Marcos said there is no need to create another task force to focus on the oil spill cleanup.
There's no need to reorganize something for everything. The idea is to have the assets in place. They're ready already as it is. The Coast Guard is heading the effort. Because they have the assets, etc., and they also are the ones coordinating with the foreign aid that's coming, that has been coming. Yung mga ROV, yung mga boom, yung mga special equipment na dinala ng Japan, pinapadala ng US.
In the meantime, the lack of work opportunities and the loss of livelihood among communities affected by the oil spill has sparked an increase in petty crimes. Pola Mayor Jennifer Cruz says incidents of theft have jumped as residents wait for aid and payments from the Cash for Work program. The mayor is appealing to affected residents not to resort to stealing.
So kailangan natin talaga ng alternative na trabaho para sa mga bugulang at para sa kabataan.
Nasa,
kasi pag hindi natin binigyan ng maayos na programa, baka magka-problema lalo.
The Southern Luzon Command has ordered all police chiefs in areas affected by the disaster to be on alert. Dozens of additional policemen were also deployed to Pola.
Identify natin yung mga coastal areas and then doon natin i-increase yung police visibility, yung police presence natin. So that maiwasan natin yung mga magsasamantala kasi natural reaction yun, may magugutom, mayroong mga ngapos na mga pangangailangan. So baka mamaya is because of that, mayroong gumawa ng hindi maganda. Ayun nga, tumaas yung petty crimes natin dito sa area.
The oil spill has since reached other areas such as Antique, Palawan, and Batangas. Dennis Datu, ABS-CBN News, Oriental, Mindoro.
Senator Sherwin Gatchalian calls for the immediate closure of Philippine Offshore Gaming Operators or POGO. Gatchalian made a call following the release of the Senate Committee on Ways and Means report on the socioeconomic benefits of maintaining POGO operations. The senator asserts banning POGOs will ensure the safety of Filipinos and sustain economic growth. That's as he cites reports of crimes linked to the industry, including kidnapping.
Based on our research, we're the only country in the whole world who is hosting POGOs. In fact, Cambodia has already restricted online gaming, no? Because of the same experience, no? The social ills and the social costs that they're experiencing. I had an interesting discussion one time in Malacanang with the Thai ambassador. How come Thailand, no, is not hosting POGOs? If it's as lucrative as what they say, how come Thailand shied away from POGO? And the simple answer is, we studied it, the social cost is just too much, no?
The Philippine President's chief legal advisor believes a repeal of a constitutional ban on nuclear weapons is the most necessary amendment to the country's charter. Juan Ponce Enrile also explained his support for a constituent assembly during a Senate hearing on proposed charter amendments. Their support from Sherian Torres.
Chief Presidential Legal Counsel and former Senate President Juan Ponce Enrile attended the hearing of the Senate Committee on Constitutional Amendments and Revision of Codes about Charter Change on Wednesday. Enrile believes the ban on nuclear weapons is the most serious and unwanted provision of the Constitution.
In the modern world today, a small country can protect itself against the superpowers if they have nuclear weapons. We should remove that restriction and make the country flexible. If we can afford it, we should also have nuclear weapons so that our people will not be trampled upon, let alone made a tuta or alipin of other countries.
But aside from a ban written in the charter, the Philippines is also one of the countries that signed the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, which bans the development, production, and stockpiling of these armaments. At least one senator agrees with Enrile on the need to have this kind of deterrent.
Doon na tayo sa nuclear age. Huwag natin i-deny yun. Talagang nandito tayo sa panahon na yon at yan naman eh, dadaan pa naman yan sa masusing pag-aaral ng Kongreso.
Enrile also urges senators not to support the position of the House of Representatives to amend the 1987 Constitution via Constitutional Convention or CONCON. Enrile argues a constituent assembly can do the job at a lesser cost.
To do a CONCON instead of a CONAPS will be a disservice to the people of this country. It will burden the taxpayers too much. To have a CONCON will entail billions of pesos to the work that can be done simply by Congress through a constituent assembly form.
Enrile was supposed to speak during an executive session but was adjusted to an open hearing following Padilla's appeal to the Senate leadership. Padilla also wants the Senate leadership to allow him to tackle Chacha with Congressman Rufus Rodriguez in a public hearing.
Kung ako po talaga ang masusunod, ma'am, para matapos na to, magharap na lang kami ni Congressman Rufus Rodriguez kasi para sa taong bayan naman po ito eh.
Sharian Torres, ABS-CBN News.
The Commission on Elections adjusts the period of the filing of certificates of candidacy for the Village and Youth Council polls. It will now be held from August 28 to September 2 from the initial filing period of July 3 to 7. COMELEC Chairman George Garcia says the adjustment is related to security concerns. The elections will be held in October this year after several delays.
Magkakaalam na kagad kung sino mga kandidato, eh baka po lalong pagsimulan niya ng violence.
Mm.
At the same time, siyempre yung PNP at saka yung AFP, ang pagpasok po kasi ng July 3 to 7, katulong na po namin sila dapat. So therefore, dapat po meron na silang resources. And more or less yung resources po ay mabibigay pa namin sa kanila mga bandang September.